Lesson 1 talk series by Dr. Rajiv Raman from Kolkata. He'll be talking on decision making in meniscal injuries. We also have a good arthroscopic panelist in the form of Dr. Mihir Patel and Dr. Nagara Shetty from Mumbai, Dr. Swapnil Kotadia and Dr. Asit Chidgukkar from Sholapur, and Dr. Chirag Tonse from Bangalore. Of course, we have the help of Dr. Ashok Shyam and Neeraj Bajlani in collecting any questions which will appear on other platforms apart from my WhatsApp number. To introduce today's speaker, Dr. Rajiv Raman, he has done his MS Orthopedics from West Bengal University of Health Sciences, presently working as consultant orthopedic surgeon at AMRI Hospital in Salt Lake, Calcutta. He has worked earlier as professor in CMC Medical College, assistant professor in CMC Medical College, Calcutta, then associate professor at North Bengal Medical College in Siliguri. He has received awards in the form of Siliguri Gold Medal Award of West Bengal Orthopedic Association. He has also received the prestigious AA Mehta Gold Medal Award of Indian Orthopedic Association. He has many honors in academic bodies, like his in the Executive Committee of West Bengal Orthopedic Associations continuously since the last 7 years. He is the former editor of Indian Arthroscopy Society Journal, former editor of Journal of West Bengal Orthopedic Association. He was the scientific chairman of West Bengal Orthopedic Association and scientific chairman of AOTS, which is a trauma meet which they conduct every year in Kolkata. Convener of DNB examination. He was the quiz master for the IOA PGPs. He is the executive member of Indian Orthopedic Association representing West Bengal, and he has delivered more than 100 guest lectures both in India and abroad. He also visits Bangladesh, Nepal, Bhutan, Thailand, and Singapore as a visiting faculty. I know one of the weekend when I was in Siliguri for a trauma meet, he had gone to Bhutan, operated for 2 days, then he had come there directly from there. So he keeps traveling to nearby countries regularly, especially Bhutan and Bangladesh, for doing the surgery. Welcome, Dr. Rajiv Raman. Friends, Dr. Rajiv Raman is very academically oriented person. I keep meeting him on almost all the academic meets, trauma as well as joint replacement arthroscopy. But since I'm not into arthroscopy, but I keep meeting him in many of the trauma meets and state and national conferences. Here you can see during a trauma meet in Kolkata, Patna, then at Kolkata, then this is recently in the month of February at Bethia in Bihar. Again, this is from Bethia only. We have an expert panel of doctors. First one is Dr. Nagara Shetty from Mumbai. He has done his MS Orthopedics, then fellowship in arthroscopy and sports medicine from South Korea and Spain. He has also done fellowship in shoulder surgery from Italy. He has taken advanced training in arthroscopy in France, Italy, and USA. He works as a consultant arthroscopy, knee and shoulder surgeon at Leelavati Hospital and Medical Research Center, Nanavati Super Speciality Hospital, Hinduja Healthcare at CARP. He is HOD, BDBA Municipal General Hospital. Welcome, Dr. Nagaraj. He is also PG teacher for Diploma in Orthopedics under CPS Mumbai. He has published many research papers which are indexed in PubMed. He is also on the reviewer board of Journal of Orthopedics and Applied Sciences. He is a national faculty for arthroscopy shoulder surgery meeting since last 7-8 years. He is an international faculty for numerous cadaveric and other courses in Asia Pacific region. Welcome, Dr. Nagaraj.
Thank you.
We have another doctor, Mihir Patel from Mumbai, as a panelist. He is an arthroscopy and sports medicine consultant. He works as assistant professor in orthopedics at HBT Medical College and Dr. Cooper Hospital in Mumbai. He has done fellowship training in arthroscopy, both knee and shoulder, from Seoul in South Korea. He is undergraduate and postgraduate teacher, recognized by the Maharashtra University of Health Sciences and also by the Diplomate of National Board from New Delhi. He is a faculty in various national and international arthroscopy meetings. He is actively involved in training new arthroscopy surgeons. He has organized many workshops as a convener of arthroscopy, especially cadaveric courses in Mumbai. I came in close contact with him when he had organized the second operative nailing course in Mumbai. He has many publications to his credit. Welcome, Dr. Mihir Patel. We have Dr. Chirag Tonse from the Garden City of India, Bangalore. He's a consultant orthopedic and arthroscopy surgeon at Vikram Hospital in Bangalore. He has special interest in shoulder and knee surgeries. He's trained extensively both in India and abroad. He's faculty in various national conferences and cadaveric courses since 2013. He is successfully running a fellowship program in arthroscopy. Right now, one of a person who is graduated and post-graduated from Sholapur is working under him, Dr. Akshay, as an arthroscopy fellow. Welcome, Dr. Chirag. We have Dr. Swapnil Kotadia, another arthroscopy and trauma surgeon from Sholapur, on the panel today. Recently, he had given a talk in the Ortho Excellence series on the proximal tibial fractures, which was very well received. He has done fellowship in sports medicine from Vienna, fellowship in foot and ankle surgeries from USA. He is faculty for live arthroscopy workshops as well as live trauma workshops. This is last year when we had conducted the Sholapur trauma meet. He was the secretary of the Sholapur Orthopedic Society, which he successfully conducted for 2 years. He has done many workshops at many places. This was at Siliguri. You can see, not Siliguri, it is in Silchar Medical College, which is beyond Bangladesh, where we had conducted workshop. He had come to demonstrate the proximal tibial fractures. With him, I have conducted many workshops at Nanded, then Bid, and so many places. Welcome, Dr. Swapnil Kotadia. We have another young orthopedic surgeon, Dr. Asish Chidugupkar, who is an arthroscopy and trauma surgeon working at Chidugupkar Hospital in Sholapur. He has done the training in arthroscopy from Dr. David Rajan in Coimbatore in 2010. Then he has worked under Dr. Ashok Rajagopal in New Delhi, both in joint replacement and arthroscopy. He has also worked with Charlie Brown in 2015 in Abu Dhabi. He is trained at Singapore National University of Health Sciences in 2018 and Royal Orthopedic Hospital, Birmingham in 2019. He is also an active Rotarian. He represents the Rotary Club of Sholapur, my own club. And he has visited many African countries like Rwanda and Gabon for medical mission under Rotary International. Welcome, Dr. Asish Chidugupkar. Friends, Dr. Asish Chidugupkar is at present secretary of Sholapur Orthopedic Association. This is the hospital where he is working. He is a state level and national level faculty for arthroscopy and joint replacements. Here you can see him during one of the state level conference, Maharashtra Orthopedic Association conference, where he was working as a faculty. This is again a recent picture where you can see Dr. Asish Chidugupkar as well as Dr. Swapnil Kotadia, the immediate past secretary of Sholapur Orthopedic Society and present secretary of Sholapur Orthopedic Society. With this brief introduction, I welcome all of you once again, and I will hand over the proceedings to Dr. Rajiv Raman for the talk on decision making in meniscal injuries. Rajiv, all yours now.
Thank you so much, sir, for this wonderful show. And it has been a very premier show on Ortho TV, one speaker, one talk series, which Dr. B. Shiv Shankar sir has started. And thanks to all the panelists, my good friend from Indian Arthroscopy Society, Dr. Mihir, Dr. Ashish, Dr. Swapnil, Dr. Chirag, Dr. Naga, and Dr. Ashok for arranging this wonderful meeting. So without wasting time, I will start my talk, the decision making in meniscal injury, which is very important. For all orthopedic surgeon and all young budding arthroscopy surgeon, because we have lots of dilemma in treating this meniscal injury. The first and most important part is that in most of this meniscal injury in daily practice, there is a big gap between what should be done and what is actually done. And if you see the literature also, you have variable opinion. You see some of the literature, they say, yes, go for a meniscal repair, meniscal balancing or meniscectomy. And you have different type of opinion available then in good index journal. So there is always a dilemma in what to do in which type of meniscal injury. So I will try to make it simplified, making it in some video session interactive with my expert colleagues also. So if you see the basic etiology, it's either a traumatic or a degenerative tear. These are two type of tear usually present in our orthopedic OPD. And most of the time, it is a debate that which is the best approach on meniscal surgery. So believe me, this is very simple for a trauma surgeon also who is starting arthroscopy. Most of the traumatic tear, if it is repairable, try to repair it. And meniscectomy is only option when it's an irreparable meniscus tear, when the meniscus tissues are not good, when the age of patient is beyond 40 years or beyond 45 years, it's a degenerative knee. In those cases, only plan for a meniscal balancing. But it is opposite in degenerative tear. Most of these degenerative tear, you have a complex type of tear. So you have meniscectomy as a first option. And most of the time, asymptomatic knee with a degenerative tear is treated conservatively. So don't treat the MRI. If you see the MRI, you will see there are complex degenerative there. The patient is only having some amount of pain over the median and lateral joint line, which is because of arthritis. The only indication for putting your scope inside or operating in those degenerative tear is either the patient is having a audible or palpable click or a locking symptoms. So one of the commonest tear we see in our day-to-day practice is the radial tear. You can see. So normally a big radial tear, you may get a fresh radial tear or you may get an old radial tear. Most of the time when you get an old radial tear, the resection of the torn part of the meniscus, that is the avascular zone, you can just balance it. And again, repair depends. And I think one of my colleague will show the horizontal tear repair, so I have not kept in this video. Depends upon the age, zone and quality of the meniscal tissue. Most of the time, if you have a large radial tear in the lateral horn of the in the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus, try to repair it. But sometime a small radial tear along with the ACL tear, you can leave it alone also. If you see 2 or 3 millimeter or 4 millimeter radial tear is there, you can balance it or you can really leave it also. But all the old radial tear which is there in the avascular zone, you go for a meniscal balancing or a smoothening of the head of the meniscus. As you can see here, there's a big radial tear, degenerative type of tear you can see. The only thing we have done is a meniscal balancing here. In this picture, you can see this is a sharp, large radial tear. In such circumstances, it depends upon the age, zone, and quality of the tissue, whether you are planning for the repair or balancing. Again, that depends upon your decision making, depends upon the per-operative findings. So when you leave it alone, and if you see, there are lots of articles in support that the fate of the meniscus tear when they are left in situ at the time of ACL reconstruction. So two type of tear, a fresh, if you can see the undersurface tear, most of the undersurface tear or a partial tear in the superior or undersurface of the lateral meniscus. If you can see that you could not put your probe from the superior part to the inferior part of the meniscus or from the undersurface toward the superior part. Those are the partial tear. These partial tear, you can leave it alone. And literature have shown that once you reconstructed the knee is stable. There is no pivoting of the knee. There is no rotatory instability of the knee. Most of this partial tear heals very well. So horizontal tear and cyst. So most of this horizontal tear, what happens? Because of the horizontal tear, the seepage of the synovial fluid is at the meniscal capsular junction. And you will get gradually with the, because of the valve mechanism, you will get some amount of fluid is getting concentrated at the meniscal capsular junction. And sometimes it's very painful also and symptomatic also. So if you are getting a patient with a horizontal tear and cyst, try to preserve as much of the meniscus as possible, because sometimes with the debridement of the seat, you see that only the rim of the meniscus has been left. But if you preserve the rim of the meniscus also, this is very important in your decision making, because that will decrease significantly the amount of contact force over that joint line. And most of the time, you can see here, this is a meniscal cyst. Chirag will show a good video also. I have just pictures here. And once you decompress the cyst, you can see the jelly-like material will come out. Now, debride this part. And sometime, you have an unstable layer also. You see the layer which is coming inside the joint is with the probe is an unstable layer. And most of the time, it's the inferior layer also. Sometimes, it's the superior layer. You just resect or balance the unstable layer. And always, if you have a horizontal tear, you have balanced it with your rim. You can see a thin horizontal line in between the superior and inferior layer. Suture with the two layer whenever possible with a vertical matrix suture. Most of this meniscal tear, if you just balance it and you don't decompress the cyst, the patient will be symptomatic and he will come back in your OPD with pain. So always, always deprive and empty the cyst and try to repair the part with a non-observable suture also. Complex tear, and these are the most challenging tear, and you must take time in planning. Suppose preoperatively in MRI also, you have decided that yes, this patient is having a complex tear. Keep all the options open and discuss with your patient. Yes, I may go for a meniscal balancing. I may go for a meniscal repair. And all these complex type of tear also, now the dictum is preserve as much of meniscus as possible. At least try to save the rim of the meniscus also to decrease the joint contact force, the force which you measure, the contact force or the friction force which you get inside the joint because of the frictional movement within the tibial and femoral condyle. And always in this complex tear, try to identify the unstable meniscus. And your sixth finger, which is your probe, is the best device. You see the unstable layer and balance it. So peripheral and long bucket handle tear, one of the commonest tear we see in our day-to-day practice. And what is important? The careful evaluation of the tear pattern. Most of the time, you will see that once you put your scope inside, the knee is locked, as you can see in this picture. So you have to unlock this knee. You have to see the tissue. You have to see the meniscal capsular junction. And if it is a fresh tear or a old tear also in a young athletic knee, try to repair this bucket handle tear, because most of the time you get a robust tissue. And if you repair it properly, the results are quite good. And the most for me, whether I will repair it or not depends upon the reducibility. Suppose you are dealing with a tear which is a 6 month or a 4 month old tear, whole of the medial border of the meniscus gets, or the undersurface of the or superior surface of the meniscus gets hypertrophied. You can see the swelling of the round type of meniscus there, and it's impossible to reduce this bucket handle tear. And sometimes those tears are only tear where you think that yes, I can go for a meniscal balancing also. But in 90% of cases, or in almost tried all of your cases, whenever possible, suture, or repair your meniscus. Degenerative meniscal tear, as I told you, it's common in degenerative knee, arthritic knee, and the principal treatment is conservative treatment, and that should be your first option. The only indication for operative treatment in degenerative tear is a history of traumatic event with a history of locking symptoms, or patient comes to your OPD with history of audible or palpable kick inside the, at the medial or lateral joint line. So most of the degenerative tear, try to treat them conservatively. Only symptomatic degenerative tear, you have to go for balancing. Believe me, it's very rare that in degenerative tear, you will need a meniscal repair, because most of the degenerative is a complex tear. They are just medial over the avascular zone only. The debridement is the best option. Don't try to repair those tissues, because failure rates are quite high if you repair those degenerative meniscal tear. Root tear. Since last decade, we have been operating in acute knee also, and these root tears are quite common. When The dictum was don't touch the knee, don't put your scope inside the knee before 6 weeks. When the knee becomes silent, we were missing this root tear. And most of the time, after 6 to 8 weeks, when we are putting our scope inside, we see that there's a laxity of the meniscus. Some of the meniscus is coming inside the joint line by pulling without having any meniscal tear. And those were the indirect signs which were suggesting that, yes, this patient has some root tear. But nowadays, since we are operating in any patient in acute setting also, so most of these root tear either associated with the anterior horn or the posterior horn of the medial or lateral meniscus should be repaired perioperatively on the same day with reconstruction of the ligament also. And with the new device, the all-inside device available, it's very easy to repair this root tear. And you can do it with your associated cruciate ligament reconstruction, either ACL reconstruction or a PCL reconstruction. So my friend, all tears are not same. So customize yourself with the type of tear. You may get a fresh tear, you may get an old tear, you may get a degenerative tear, you may get a tear in a young population or an older population. So you have to customize your treatment according to the type of the tear, age of the patient, and the zone of the tear. Now I have few cases. So let's start with my good friend here, all the arthroscopy friend. So first, please, sorry. So this is a 10-week old bucket handle tear. You can see the whole of the knee. Once you put your scope inside, and this is a very common finding, you see the knee is locked. You see the meniscal tissue here. So 10-week old bucket handle tear. So Chirag, how do you approach these patients? So what are, Chirag? So what is your time limit when you think, no, I will go for a meniscectomy in this patient, or up to this time limit, I will repair my meniscus. So Chirag, please unmute yourself.
Yeah, Dr. Rajiv, can you hear me?
Yeah, please.
So decision-making in a bucket handle tear would depend on three parameters. One is the age and activity demand of the patient. Second is it a medial meniscus or a lateral meniscus? And third is the tissue condition and the time duration lapsed since the meniscus tear. Now, looking into the first thing, activity demand of the patient. If a patient is probably, you need to speak to him before you take a decision. You need to know whether he is an active athlete who needs to return back to his sports immediately, or else does he have a time frame for a recovery period? You usually need to tell them before they get into contact sports, at least 6 months when you repair a bucket handle tear. If the patient is not willing for the same, if it's a loss of a season, loss of revenue for him, and it's a setback in his game, then always give him an option of a meniscectomy. Now, considering the tear pattern or the tear location, is it in the lateral meniscus or a medial meniscus? Lateral meniscus holds to be more important than a medial meniscus in terms of repair. So bucket handle lateral meniscus for me is always a repair until unless the patient says no, or the tissue condition is not good. Now, third, the time duration and the tissue quality. It's very, very important that we have good, fresh, bleeding edges. I mean, for me, time frame doesn't matter. If the tissue is good and if I can get good, fresh bleeding surface after debriding on both the surfaces, then definitely I will go ahead and repair this kind of a meniscus. They say a time frame of 6 weeks, 10 weeks, 3 months. Some people even say 6 months, but I think up to 6 months, if the tissue quality is good, young patient, cartilage is good, and if he's got a good, fresh bleeding surface, I think we should go ahead and repair it, especially the red zone tears.
Good. So the good point has come out of Chirag is that most of the time, if you have a robust tissue, duration is not a factor. Earlier, we used to say, earlier it was a dictum that up to 12 weeks repair, beyond 12 weeks don't repair. So debride your tissue, reduce your meniscus, see, then decide. Don't make a decision on timing just that it's a 10-week old tear and I will not repair it, just I will go for a meniscectomy. But because once you have removed the meniscus, you can't regenerate that meniscus. So decisions making is very important. And the most important part is reduction. So with the valgus force, you can see, put your probe over the undersurface. And this is important. So Chirag, how do you reduce sometimes irreducible meniscus? I think Mihir, how do you reduce this irreducible meniscus? Because this time, it was 10 weeks old, it's come back easily. Sometimes it's irreducible. Any tip and tricks for the audience?
So usually what happens is these bucket handle tears who come to you after a very long time, or they come to you in a clinical status of a locked knee, will have issues of reducing the bucket. The issue is then you need to open the medial joint space more than what it can open. So I would usually not hesitate. In fact, I do the medial bicrusting of the MCL at the joint level all the time. That gives you a very good opening, and then that medial bucket reduces very easily. You can do your assessment and then go ahead with the repair. So I would usually do a medial bicrusting of the MCL to open the joint space and then push the bucket handle back into its place.
So just opinion of the house, Dr. Swapnil. So for bicrusting, you do at a joint line or you do at a TBL level, TBL side? MCL bicrusting.
Almost at the joint level.
Almost at the joint line. And Dr. Nagraj, bicrusting?
I do it at the tibial side. I do it because I feel that the posterior fibers of the superficial MCL and the posterior oblique ligament, they are the ones which are responsible for your working space, which is near extension primarily, or about 20-30 degree flexion. So if you target the POL and the posterior superficial MCL fibers, which is easier for me because I use the tibia as a landmark and then go posteriorly, it opens adequately and in the working space in the near extension.
So that is important. But Nagraj, so I also believe that I also go for a bicrusting TBL site. But yes, literature, there are enough support that you can go, because if you want to open the joint maximally, it's the joint line bicrusting which will give you maximum opening. But at 20 or 30 degree of flexion, you want to release the posterior part of the MCL, and I think the tibial side release also works good, and sometimes it is said also it's less painful, so less painful than your joint line release. So once you have reduced it, so how do you start your reduction, Ashit, from anterior to posterior putting your probe, or from posterior to anterior? Ashit, I think there is some audio issue with Ashit, so we can take this question with Dr. Ashit. We can't hear you. Dr. Nagraj, please, if you can take this question.
Yeah, so typically, when a meniscus is locked, there are a couple of factors which are holding it back. One is these patients sometimes have a prominent medial tibial spine. So when you put your hook probe just above the medial tibial spine and you are giving a valgus force, you've done the bicrusting and you give a counter force with the probe, usually it comes. Sometimes if it's difficult, I use the trocar, a blunt trocar to push it in. If it's further difficult, I use a shaver in a burr mode and try to burr out some amount of the medial tibial spine and then again try to push it in. I think
so very good. Very good two techniques that you can burr the spine also sometime, or the best thing is your sixth finger that you probe, and always try to reduce from the posterior part because you have more opening on this part. So you try to push the posterior horn of the meniscus first, and you once you can reduce the posterior part, you can see it will go back easily like a cakewalk over the medial body part, and the anterior horn will go very easily. So always start your reduction with the posterior part and then start your repair. Again, your repair sequence, it start from the posterior part. You can take a horizontal or a vertical mattress stitches. So my question with Mihir, so what type of suture you prefer? It's a vertical mattress or a horizontal, and why?
So in a bucket handle tear, it will always be a vertical mattress with one stitch going into the capsule and the other stitch going into the substance, the RR or the RW zone of the meniscus. So we can coap the meniscus very firmly against the capsule. But that I think is most important. And the second reason why I would do vertical is when you do a horizontal mattress, you're buckling the meniscus up, which I feel affects the vascularity and directly affects the future healing of the meniscus.
Yeah, so vertical tear has a good vertical mattress has a good cinching effect, and sometimes if you want to reduce the cost also, because you can take more tissue, you can take for horizontal bite also, but always vertical stitches are good than horizontal stitches. So this is the second case. A 28 year male football player came with a ACL tear. So while probing the lateral meniscus, this is the finding. You can see, I will remove this sound, unmute this sound. I can see there is an under surface tear. You can see here, this is under surface tear. So partial tear of the lateral meniscus, under surface of the lateral meniscus with ACL tear. Nagraj, how will you approach in this such type of tear?
So although this video is not complete, we can fairly make out that this is the popliteal meniscal fascicle area. You can see the popliteus tendon there.
Yeah.
So this could be an injury to the popliteal meniscal fascicles. And I would obviously rely on the probing. So if it's extremely mobile, beyond the normal mobility of the normal lateral meniscus, only then I would be concerned about the popliteal meniscal fascicle injury. And then you can use your all-inside devices, but you need to make sure that you don't narrow that popliteus tendon space much. So I'll use the reverse curved fast fix. Now, this, as you are showing in the video, the viewing is from the anterolateral portal. The hook probe has come from the anteromedial portal. Mm-hmm. And that is exactly what you need to do when you are dealing with the tears here, because you want to come from the diagonally opposite portal. You want to go away from the midline. You want to make sure that the knee is beyond 90 degree flexion. And you want to make sure that you don't narrow the popliteal hiatus in that area. So you can use a reversed all-inside device for this sort of a tear with these tips and tricks.
Chirag, your say on such type of tear, it's a very common we see our day-to-day practice. And
what I see in this, you're holding your probe there, and what I see, the length of the tear is somewhere around 5 to 6 millimeters, considering the probe is about 4 millimeters.
Yes.
It's a short, stubble tear, less than 50% of the depth of the meniscus. It's a stable tear and in the red zone. I would leave it alone.
All right, good.
When you do and doctor, there is also bleeding in that surface, so...
So, Dr. Swapnil, your opinion for such type of tear?
Yes, if it is a partial and it is obviously seems to be in a red zone. And if it is a young fellow, fresh injury, of course, it's better to conserve it with maybe I will ask him to offload his knee for at least 3 weeks with some passive range of movement. And then we can start again his routine activity also.
All right. So what Dr. Nagaraj told, that is also important. If you have a large tear, it's an unstable tear, you have to repair it because that is in the, your popliteal fascicular reason. What Dr. Chirag and Dr. Swapnil told, I did the same because it was a partial tear, undersurface tear, and you can see it was not coming inside the joint. So just I saved the undersurface. And believe me, most of this ACL tear, you will see this such type of partial tear. You just deprive the undersurface. Once you reconstruct your ACL, these tear will not progress. They will heal jolly well. And even if you probe it later on, scope it later on, you will see it has healed jolly well. So I think for small stable tear, partial tear, just deprive the undersurface and leave it alone. Reconstruct your ACL because that knee is going to be on rest for another 8 to 12 weeks and you will have a good fibrous healing over that part.
And what will be the post-operative protocol when you conserve these patients?
So, see, it's the same for ACL tear with a undersurface meniscus tear. It will not progress because if you load this knee with flexion and extension also, it will not progress because the knee pivoting has gone. You have reconstructed your ACL, so these knees are now stable knee. So, healing rates are quite good if you treat them conservatively. So it's a normal ACL rehab protocol we follow in such type of partial tear, undersurface tear.
You can wait for the
Yeah, and if we repair it, then it's like that. We keep them non-operative for 3 to 4 weeks, depending upon the type of the tear. So bucket handle tear, normally it's 4 to 6 weeks. We keep it them non-weight bearing or partial weight bearing for 4 to 6 weeks.
Yes, Mihir has a question. Yes, Mihir.
Yes.
So Rajiv, through you, I would ask the same question to Swapnil and Chirag or to you too. Would the management be the same if there was no ACL tear in this patient?
Good question. Yes, Chirag.
Yeah,
I will give my opinion. Let's have.
Yeah.
Only undersurface tear.
Yeah. So as I said, I just defined my indications for a repair of a meniscus. If the meniscus tear is less than 1 centimeter, short, stable tear, and which is not dislocating into the intercondylar notch on probing, that means it's a stable tear, and if it's less than 50% of the thickness of the meniscus. And it's in the red zone, I would conserve this.
Yes.
Even if it's probably I may make a little bit of trepanations in the intercondylar notch for the bleeding, or else just freshen it with a shaver blade under surface. That's all. Just create some bleeding in the joint and that would heal.
So partial tear, yes, Mihir, my opinion is same. For partial tear, usually we treat them conservatively, it's stable. Yes, your rehab protocol differs, because if you see the ACL is intact in the partial tear, try to keep these knee in protected way for 4 to 6 weeks, and most of this partial tear will heal jolly well, because under surface tear has a good healing potential than your superior tear. What is your opinion, Dr. Nagraj, regarding the healing of the under surface and the superior surface tear?
I think in this area you see two varieties of tears. You see, anything that is posterior to the popliteus is generally having a good vascularity. Mm-hmm. You also see the small longitudinal tears above the meniscus, mm-hmm. which on probing are quite stable. There again the same principle applies. You rasp, use your needle itself like a trepanation. And what I always have wondered, if there is no budgetary issues, your devices are itself working like trephines. They are creating those vascular channels. So you're not losing anything, as long as you make sure that you don't narrow the popliteal hiatus. There's a lot of discussion about popliteal meniscal fascicle injury. We've had some good talks on these also. And we need to look at this particular rent under surface. If it's a regular rent or it's a slightly larger rent, the mobility is slightly more than what your experience tells you. You very well can leave them alone, but if you're repairing them, you can be confident that it's going to heal either ways, because the vascularity is very good posterior to the popliteus, above and below.
Ashit, can you say something so that we know whether you are audible or not?
Yeah, Ashit, I think Ashit
is not audible.
No, some issue is there.
Yeah.
Ashit, you can join with your mobile also. I think that is the way. You can join with your mobile, I think, because you... The only way you can't present, but you can at least interact. Join with your mobile.
Ashit, you can mute this and join with a mobile audio.
Yeah, that is the best option. So case three, this scenario is very common also. We see most of these.
Raju, can I interrupt?
Yeah, please, Swapnil.
The only thing is, if when you are repairing under surface tear, either on the mainly on the lateral meniscus, any tips and tricks while repairing this, and what are the instrument we use for that, which is the good instrument to use?
Yeah, normally see, you can use your you can use your normal meniscus repair device, but most of this posterior horn lateral meniscus tear I use all inside technique only, because I don't go for the inside out or outside in technique. The chances of injury of the common peroneal nerve is high. So go for an all-inside technique, and normal all-inside any meniscal suture repair device which you are comfortable, you can use.
I'll just
add a quick angulation.
Yes, Swapnil, not audible.
Any yes. Specific angulation of the all-inside implant of your choice?
Yeah, that you can take. You have two angles. Normally, with different companies, different angle devices are available. It's a, if you see the MyTech, it's a 16 and 24 device. Different. Yeah, it depends whether you, how which one is approaching. Normally, for posterior, you can use the high angular device, and those devices are good for the posterior horn. Yeah.
I'll just add a few tips and tricks here.
Yes, please.
Yeah, so like Rajiv showed, typically your visualization is in the anterolateral portal. Your anteromedial portal may not be in the ideal trajectory for reaching that area. So get your spinal injury from the anteromedial portal. If you have a prominent lateral tibial spine, and if you feel that your devices are not coming at an angle, you go for a higher portal. That's the first trick. Now, if you find that your higher portal, your higher anteromedial portal is giving the trajectory, well and good, use a reverse curve device, go away from the midline. Sometimes what happens is you might actually have to go very close to the patellar tendon, almost like a transpatellar tendon portal, close to the edge of the patellar tendon. And rarely you might even want to go through the transpatellar tendon portal. So any of these which can give you that ideal trajectory from high up to low and away from the midline, you can use.
Okay. And what are the types of suture we take for this? I mean, horizontal or again vertical?
Vertical. Always vertical as... Usually vertical, yes.
It's inferior and partial.
Yes. So you go through the capsular side. So usually I use a reverse curve device. You go through the capsular side first, and then you turn
inferior
it around.
Side.
You go through the meniscal side first, and then you turn it around and go through the capsular side.
Second. The best thing is that the reverse curve device is that you can use it. Or if you don't have a reverse curve device, you have to rotate it.
One more thing, gradually you can do. Actually, you can. Somebody has to mute, I think. So one more thing you can do is once you've taken one accessory portal, from the medial portal, you can get your hook probe, lift that meniscus up, ask your assistant to lift it up. And from your accessory portal, okay, your device can be actually managed wherever, however you want it.
Okay. And one more thing, just for practically for everyone, if you know that there is only a lateral meniscus injury, like in the case without any ACL or meniscus injury seen on MRI as well as clinical. So we take a normal anterolateral viewing portal. Okay. Then while doing anteromedial petal, whether you first use a spine needle and try how easy to go up to the lateral meniscus and then you take the anteromedial portal, or you take a routine anteromedial portal and then you change over to some other portal if it is not, your trajectory is not going well.
Raji, you want to take that first, then I'll come in.
Yeah. So it's needle technique is always good because that will guide you sometime. And sometime when you see by the needle technology that yes, your tibial spine is coming there, so you can make a high anteromedial portal also. So that is the best option, because once you have made your portal and you redecide that I have to make a second portal, you are putting a second incision over the medial aspect. That is a small part only there. So it's always better to go with a needle technique. And by this technique, you can decide also, yes, whether I have to go for some amount of abrasion of the tibial spine also to put my instruments there over the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus. Yes, Nagraj, yes, anything to add?
Yeah, just one thing. As a sequence, over the years, what has happened is that I look at the medial compartment first. It is just as a sequence. And if I have to look at it and probe it, then I have to create my portal outside in for the medial meniscus first. And if I find a lateral meniscus tear, as I told you, I'll take an accessory portal. But I keep this in mind, what you just asked. If I have, a discoid meniscus, a very young child with a discoid meniscus with an unstable tear where I would do a part meniscectomy, part repair, these cases, I would make sure that my medial portal is very medial so that the instruments get access to the discoid portion, all posterior, central and anterior. So that is a good question. You can use this for such cases where you create under vision the medial portal for the lateral, primary lateral tears. Yes.
Always good to create an under vision for such type of repair. You can see where your needle is going. You see whether tibial spine is coming or not. Because most of the football player, you will see there is a hypertrophy of this tibial spine. And in those players also, only, it's very difficult to repair the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus. And you have to sometimes abrade it. So this is the third case. Yeah, we can start with our third case because we have three case presentation by our expert panel also. So a 27-year male with acute road traffic accident presented 5 days after injury. Patient has a complete ACL tear, LCL tear, and you can see because today we are discussing the meniscus only, the avulsion of the root of the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus, you can see, and the opening of the joint line because of the LCL tear. So Asit, I think you are now, you can speak. No, Asit, I think it's not audible. Chirag, how will you address such type of root avulsion? It's not a typical root avulsion. You can see it has gone.
Asit, you shut down your computer and join from mobile only.
Yes, Chirag.
Yeah. So, Dr. Rajiv, these tears have to be addressed. There's no second question that this will be left alone anyway.
All right.
An ACL with the lateral meniscus root tear, the pivot will be grade 3 invariably. And until unless we cater to these lateral meniscus root tears, even if you do a ACL reconstruction, at times you will see that the pivot is still positive. So I will do a simultaneously ACL reconstruction and a root repair as well. So in lateral meniscus root avulsions, for me, there is no role of all inside root repair. It's only inside out using a tibial jig.
All
right. Using a tibial jig. So I would make an additional tunnel for this and repair of the root as routinely how we repair it. In fact, lateral, with this kind of an opening, it's very easy to get an access to this root and repair it.
Yeah. So it's a blessing in disguise. If you have a LCL tear, you can have a good joint space over the lateral side. It's always easy to put your instrument there. Nagraj, any difference in opinion or same?
No, absolutely. Like Chirag said, there'll be a blowout pivot phenomenon. The only thing probably is that for the beginners, especially when you're passing your stitches through the lateral meniscus root, unlike on the medial meniscus, you need to turn your anterograde device other way around. You cannot go like this. You need to go the other way around. Only then you can pass your scorpion-like devices. And nowadays, all of us are using tapes, mini tapes, usually two tapes. And like Chirag said, then you do a pull-out suture technique. Usually, the lateral meniscus root tunnel is vertical and lower as compared to the ACL tunnel, which is horizontal and oblique, and it comes from the higher side. These are the various tips and tricks.
So, one thing was there in this patient, this is for Swapnil. You see, there was a good amount of cartilage loss over the undersurface of the meniscus. Very rare scenario. And first time I have seen such type of cases where you have a cartilage loss over the undersurface of the meniscus. So, Swapnil, how do you address this cartilage? Do you do anything for this cartilage loss, or what would you plan in such type of patients?
If it is exactly at the root, I think, anyways, we are removing the cartilage while we are repairing the root.
So it is not root, it's over the condyle. You can see here, this is the undersurface, this is your root, and here you have a cartilage loss. Cartilage loss here. If you can see here, you can see, yes, now you can see here. You can see this cartilage loss here, yeah, undersurface.
Not seen any time actually.
Okay. Nagraj, your opinion? Nagraj is doing lots of cartilage repair.
On the tibial side, yes, it is very uncommon, but I've seen it. And if it's an incidental finding, small defect, then you can get away using your microfracture hole technique. It's always available with you. You can drill some holes there. But just for theoretical purpose, there are retrograde Oates techniques where you can use your Oates system in a retrograde manner. So you can use your ACLG, create your tunnel, and then your retrograde, you can push it up. These are available for the even for the lateral side, tibial sided defect.
Chirag, any difference in opinion here?
No, as Dr. Nagraj sir said, this is definitely, it will require a microfracturing. I would do a microfracture, but only challenges what we have faced in these kind of scenarios is our typical 15 degrees or 45 degrees bent of our microfracture awl is not useful here. You need to have 90 degrees of microfracture awl. If you do not have that, don't attempt it. Because one is getting an axis and second, getting the trajectory is very, very difficult with the 45 degrees microfracture awl. You need to have a 90 degree awl for this.
So, Mihir, yes, you want to say something.
Yeah, I think the MCL tear is a boon in this case. So according to me also, it's going to be lateral meniscal repair with microfracture.
Yeah, so that is the important point. So sometimes you have a fresh injury, also go for a microfracture since we are dealing with meniscus tissue choosing, and most of the time try to repair it. And it's now we have good all inside device there by which you can take bite. And the most important step is creating a good crater for the healing of the root. And you should remove the cartilage from the posterior part, the root part, because whole of your root will heal over that crater only. So the only thing, the inadequate thing we do is inadequate preparation of that crater. And you can see with the SLG, just I have made my tunnel. You take the lasso outside, and this is the all inside. You can see the device, the passing device by which you can take bite, and gradually after taking this bite, you can see here. And so once you take the bite, you put your knot here. And now we are using, this was done 5 years back, and we are using the fiber tape. So it was a fiber wire, and put your knot there, then try to pass you. So you can put one or two wire like this, and after that, put just tie it over the anterior part of the tibia with a post or a disc. What is important, you can see after microfracture, you can see the whole of this undersurface, the lost cartilage, the where we had a cartilage loss, covered by the meniscal tissue only. The only thing is that keep this patient non-weight bearing for 6 to 8 weeks.
No,
give good time off for cartilage healing so that you can.
Only when you are asking question, you can.
Yeah. So when you be less aggressive in rehabilitation of such type of patient. So most of this root avulsion, if it is a fresh case or a old case, you have to go for repair. Cartilage lesion, if it is a fresh one or a old one, go for microfracture. Yes, if you are very comfortable with retro Oates, you can go with a retro Oates technique. For me, small cartilage defect would do well with a microfracture only, because you have a good cover of the meniscal tissue over the raw surface of the cartilage.
So Rajiv, one thing I'd like to ask in this case. So, I had a patient who had an ACL tear. He had a lateral meniscus root avulsion and he had a lateral sided injury also, acute mm-hmm. lateral sided injury also. So obviously the combination of ACL with acute lateral sided injury is less common as compared to a multi-ligament scenario where there is an ACL lateral sided injury. Now, if you have that scenario, normally in my practice, I would do these arthroscopic procedures of meniscus repair and combine it with the lateral sided repair SOS added augmentation, but I wouldn't do the ACL reconstruction in the same sitting because of the risk of arthrofibrosis, because these are acute knees and you want to make sure there is no arthrofibrosis per se. So that is to be kept in mind. Although you could attempt all three together also, just making sure that there is no arthrofibrosis.
Yeah, so there are two school of thoughts. You can go for a one go or a two go, as Nagaraj told. Definitely, there is a good advantage in one go. It's cost effective, but disadvantage is that there is risk of arthrofibrosis. And the disadvantage of two go is that it's very the patient has to be a two type operative cost. But advantage is that chances of developing of arthrofibrosis is less. Good point, Albert. So this is the last case, I think. After that, we will have case.
Mihir has a question. Yes, Mihir.
Yeah, please, Mihir.
Yeah, Rajiv, in continuation with what Nagaraj mentioned about the timing, for me, only the knee range of motion is important to decide. If the patient has got 90 or more knee range of motion, I'm going to do everything in one stage.
Yes.
If the range of motion is less than 90, which means there is traumatic synovitis, I will restrict my intra-articular procedure to minimum only meniscal repair and come out.
Yeah. So this is a good point, but most of the acute knee, you don't have issue with the range of motion. It's a neglected cases only when you see there's some amount of loss of flexion because of pain or some patient has been immobilized for a prolonged period. So this is a fourth case scenario. This is very common. Most of the time when we see a symptomatic discoid, we balance the discoid, you have an unstable peripheral rim, So Mihir, how do you address this unstable peripheral rim? Whether you go for a complete meniscectomy or you try to preserve this unstable peripheral rim?
No, so my principle of managing a discoid meniscus, which is symptomatic.
Yes.
Number first step is two steps. First step is saucerization. Convert the D into a C to give a rim of about, to give a stable rim. If the rim is unstable, then I'm going to repair it. I feel maintenance of the peripheral rim, which is stable, is very important for future knee function. Yes. So saucerization, evaluate for stability, and then repair.
Nagaraj, how do you repair this unstable rim? Suppose most of the arthroscopy surgeon, we believe that we should keep the meniscal rim intact. So what is your preferred technique of repairing this unstable peripheral rim of discoid meniscus?
So in a discoid lateral meniscus, the instability is usually in the posterior lateral corner behind the tendon of popliteus. So for me, any repairs behind the tendon of popliteus are all inside devices. Very often we get these discoid meniscus on the medial side also, but not as common as the discoid lateral. And in discoid medial meniscus, I've seen that the instability is more in the midsection in the region of the MCL. And for me, repair on the medial side is usually always in-to-out technique.
Yeah, Chirag, any difference of opinion?
So usually, I mean, 9 out of 10 patients of discoid meniscus who come to us are with complex tears. It's very, very unlikely that only with the discoid meniscus symptoms without a tear.
Very true. Yeah.
So most of the time when we go ahead and see, and these are neglected ones because primarily they're not picked up. And when we go ahead, it's usually a complex tear of the body and the posterior horn. And we start saucerizing it and ultimately we are left to do about 2 to 3 millimeters of this peripheral portion, which is usually a horizontal cleavage type of tear, which is unstable. Now, where to fix that posterior part? Is it worthwhile fixing it, converting that complex tear into a simple tear and then fixing it to the popliteus? That's the surgeon's choice, I think so. If the tissue is good, if it's a young patient and if the surgeon feels that it's worthwhile fixing it, fix it. If not, it may be a nuisance in the future date where it may become unstable or it may be painful. If you're confident it's going to heal, then it's better to fix it up.
Yeah. So, Swapnil, what's your opinion for... Unmute yours.
Unmute, Swapnil.
Okay, can you hear?
Yeah.
Yes, please.
So, I think it all depends upon your meniscal tear anatomy. If it is very clear cut, then really it's better to fix it. Okay, but as Chirag said, usually we end up in excision of the meniscus most of the times in discoid tear.
Nagraj wants to add first. Yeah, Nagraj, please.
Yeah, yeah. A couple of things I'd like to add with the experience which I've seen. Now, many a times these are very young, small children, and you realize that by the process of meniscectomy, it's going to be a near total meniscectomy practically. And we all know that these are young girls, and by the time they are in the adolescence, they're going to land up with lateral compartment osteoarthritis because most of them also have a valgus malalignment. Keeping this in mind, I would give importance to, before I, like Mihir mentioned, you start with the saucerization, but I always limit my saucerization nowadays. I rely on the repair part first. Once the repair is established, once the meniscocapsular junction is established, then you can decide how much is left. Because once you have resected, there is nothing much you can do after that. You're suddenly left with a few meniscus tissue to deal with. That's the first tip. Second thing is, in front of the popliteus, there are some tears which are completely unstable. It's like a bucket handle. The whole thing is just coming off. Also in front of the popliteus also, it's very unstable. So the outside-in technique is very useful for all these tears. So you can take a small incision, use your outside-in technique, take multiple stitches and stabilize the anterior portion of this tear. Obviously, the posterior portion can be handled with your all-inside devices. Not for discoid meniscus per se, but even for bucket handle meniscus tear in children, when you're doing your epiphyseal sparing techniques, you can actually take an incision laterally as a primary goal. You take an incision laterally, create your plane, dissect the lateral head of gastroc from the posterior lateral capsule. Once you have that plane, you can also do inside out repairs for the posterior area. And the same incision can be used for outside and drilling, you know, epiphyseal sparing drilling. So these are the various tips and tricks for children with lateral sided.
Good point from Nagraj. One good thing is that he told that you repaired the rim first and then try to go for resection so that you can keep most of the meniscal tissue. What we follow normally, we resect the tissue, then we see the peripheral rim is there and we have a very thin rim only to repair. So this is a good point, well taken. So most of the time you can go with any type of device, but this is very cost effective device. You can see the you can use your all inside device. You can see there's a horizontal tear. And with single suture, you can just put three or four vertical matrix suture, you can see here. And this with this all inside device, you can put three or four stitches there. And by this stitches, you can just just stabilize the whole of the unstable part of the discoid meniscus, the peripheral rim of the discoid meniscus. The only, I think the video is not working here. The only thing is, good thing is that with this all inside suture passing device, it's with single suture, you can just repair all of the unstable layer horizontal tear from posterior aspect to the anterior aspect. And it's very cost effective also. Because for putting vertical or horizontal matrix stitches, three or four stitches, it usually increases the cost of your procedure because every suture is very costly. All inside sutures are very costly. But this technique is very cost effective technique and we can use it to stabilize the unstable layer of the discoid, peripheral rim of the discoid meniscus.
Chirag wants to add something. Yes,
yeah, Chirag. Please, Chirag.
Yeah. Rajiv, we just saw that meniscus in the picture there.
Yeah.
How happy are you? Most commonly, we see that kind of a frayed tissue and with that fatty infiltrations, what we see inside the meniscus there. How happy are we seeing that?
See, it's most of the time you will see because it's type of it's the patient comes usually after when the knee is symptomatic only, so you have a complex type of tear over the rim. So if you see the fatty type of tissue, you can go for trephination also. But always meniscectomy has not been a good option for me for last 5 years. Most of the time I try to keep as much of rim as possible because I'm afraid if I go for meniscectomy, saying the degenerative tissues or the fatty degeneration of the tissue, this patient is going to have osteoarthritic or arthritic changes in future course of time.
Yeah. How many millimeters would you keep? A rim of about 3 millimeters or you would like to?
Minimum 2 to 3 millimeters I would like to keep. Mihir, you want to add something? Yes.
Yeah. So Chirag, continuing your question, the principle that we follow of the dividing the meniscus into three zones, RR, RW, and WW. If you reach the original article, this RR, RW, or WW is only for the posterior horn of the medial meniscus. And the vascularity in the lateral meniscus and its three zones of the lateral meniscus is also completely different. So we need to basically get back to the original article. And if you read the article, you'll realize that the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus has its vascularity almost into the WW zone also.
Yes.
Having said that, when you put some sutures in the meniscal video that Dr. Rajiv showed, and if you ever get a chance to have a second look arthroscopy, you'll realize that there is very good synovial tissue which engulfs the entire meniscus and holds it together. Now, whether there is any healing tissue or not, I am also not aware. I would show you in my video also, and it beautifully takes up. What is important is we have to understand that a meniscal tear has to be treated as a fracture non-union. And the most important part in a fracture non-union is not the fixation, but the preparation of the tear and getting biology there. Once you get biology there, then no matter you put one suture, you put five sutures or eight sutures, the synovial tissue that comes over takes over the biology and helps in healing. So I feel that preparation of the tear is the most important, irrespective of what kind of device, what kind of suture you use.
Agreed. I think, Ashit, are you audible?
Yeah, can you hear me now?
Yes, yes.
Am I audible?
Yes, yes, please, Ashit. Yeah, yeah.
Nice.
So, now we want to hear from you. Yes, please.
The point that I think we're missing is how many of us use blood clots? You draw 50 cc of blood intraoperatively and make a clot and you put it whenever you are using doing a bucket handle tear. How many of you?
I've seen, but I have not used it. I don't know any expert panel, any of you using Chirag.
Anybody on the panel?
No. Joshi sir used it and they have shown very good results.
So I've seen Dr. Charlie Brown do that.
Ashit, do you use them?
Yes, sir. I do use them. I learned it from Charlie Brown. Mm-hmm. And you draw 50 cc of blood and you just gently start, rotating activity and you make a fibrin clot. Mm-hmm. So you've got the fast fix tubes and you use that to put in the clot inside. You switch off your fluid at that time. And I think it sits where it needs to sit.
Yes,
Mihir. Yes, Asir, in continuation to your discussion, do you stabilize the clot in the tear with some suture? Or you just leave it there?
No. Of course, there is stabilization.
Of the clot?
No. Not of the clot. Just keep it there.
Yeah.
It's like a sandwich between the two tier joint, and he is putting a stitch there.
Yeah. So I do what Chirag had mentioned. I would make these micro fractures in the intercondylar notch to stimulate bleeding in a non-cruciate reconstruction case. Because once you deflate the tourniquet, there is only bone marrow all over. Yeah. So I think that helps. But I think this bone marrow is a good, the blood clot is a good idea, especially in a non-cruciate case.
And if you have reconstructed your ACL, the femoral tunnel blood will only get sipped there. Yes, it will get sipped there only. So I think we can go for case presentation. Sir Shankar, sir, what is the
Fine. Case presentation? We'll start with Chirag.
Yeah, Chirag.
Yeah, I can. More of a simpler case of mine. So I think we can start with a simple case and then go with the rest of the panels. Is my screen getting shared?
Yes.
Yeah, you can make it full screen.
Yeah. Till this gets on, probably we can take some questions and
make it presentation mode, Chira. Yeah. Good.
Stuck somewhere. Give me a minute, please. Just give me a second, please.
So, Rajiv, until Chirag comes up with his presentation, what gauge suture do you use for your meniscal repair?
It's 2-0 only.
And would you do anything special to save cost? Because you mentioned that these sutures are very expensive.
Yeah. So, see, the inside all technique also, I normally... after taking this double needle also, I can take 2 or 3 vertical stitches because just you take the needle out, you can put the knot and I can just repair those meniscus. Or the best thing is that keep the suture. Suppose your posterior horn you have fixed with all inside, you have cut the suture, you can, the rest of the suture you can use for inside out or outside in technique also. So I usually do it in all my cases to reduce the cost of repair.
Yeah, so I will show you my technique in my case.
yeah, definitely. Would love to see that. Chirag, please.
I think we are good to go. On the outside, I'd like to thank the Indian Orthopedic Association and Dr. Shiv Shankar for providing this platform, and Dr. Rajiv Raman for wonderful cases what he showed us. Let me just show you a common case scenario which we usually encounter, and it may go unnoticed, and sometimes we are in a dilemma what to do exactly in such cases. 34-year-old housewife complains of knee pain on and off since the last 3 months. Now it's become a little severe in the last couple of weeks' time. It's localized to a lateral joint line, and it's more on ascending stairs. She complains of pain while sitting with a flexed knee. It lessens on extension. She says that when I extend the knee and non-weight bear, I'm a little better. There's no instability whatsoever and no significant history of injury. Of course, she says that I have had some small injuries while at housework, in the stairs, sometime in the past, but it is not something grossly which needed some kind of an intervention or treatment. She says, sometimes I have this intermittent clicking or catching kind of a sensation in the knee joint, and that is what bothers her more, along with the pain. On examination, we see here, there was a mild joint effusion. The range of movement was pretty much normal. There was a 1 to 2 centimeter palpable mass on the lateral joint, which reduces on knee flexion and reappears on knee extension. A tenderness right at that spot, McMurray test could not be elicited, and which was not conclusive, and no ligament laxities. I would ask the panel, what is the first diagnosis which we would, as an orthopedic surgeon, as an orthopedic surgeon, what would be our probably first diagnosis we would look into? A large osteophyte, 35-year-old lady, a synovial cyst, proximal tibiofibular joint cyst, traumatic bursitis, lipoma, parameniscal cyst, avulsion injury, or bucket handle meniscus tear. Dr. Ashit?
Meniscus cyst.
Mihir? Dr. Mihir?
Yeah, my first differential diagnosis will be a parameniscal cyst. I will keep a proximal tibiofibular joint cyst as my second DD.
Okay, Dr. Rajiv and Dr. Rajiv?
Maybe Dr. Mihir said.
So, X-ray didn't. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Acid, I'll mute you because the echo is from your side, Acid. Yeah, please continue.
And does the panel think that ultrasound would be a good evaluation, or directly we would go into an MRI scan? Nagraj, sir?
I would go for an MRI scan because I think what is important here is that you need to understand if it's a parameniscal cyst, meaning there is a meniscus tear through which the synovial fluid has seeped out through the ball valve mechanism and causing the cyst. Because it can happen that you do have cysts in the vicinity of the meniscus without having a meniscus tear. So an MRI is the only way you will understand if that is the scenario.
Yeah, that's exactly what we did. I mean, there's no much of role of ultrasound. Of course, in the peripheries maybe, but in today's date where we have things which are much advanced, this is exactly what her MRI revealed. She did have a horizontal cleavage kind of a tear in the body and the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus, and also a small parameniscal cyst, which was quite significant. And this was the cause for her pain and discomfort. Now, what is the options we have here? Ultrasound guided large bore needle aspiration with the corticosteroid injection, arthroscopic meniscectomy, arthroscopic meniscectomy, that is cystectomy, and a percutaneous cyst decompression. Decompression plus meniscus repair or an open cyst decompression.
Third. Sorry, Chirag, I got a chance to speak now.
Okay.
Yeah, please. Ashit, yes.
It's third option for me.
So you would go in for an arthroscopic meniscectomy, cystectomy, and percutaneous decompression.
Yeah, and maybe try and put two sutures and close it. And if it's not possible, then take a small nick outside and just suture it so that it doesn't come out again.
Do you add fibrin also?
No, not here.
Okay.
Before we go on to the video, can I just get an
option? Yeah, sure.
Yes.
How many of us, is anybody in favor of option one? Which used to be I mean, we used to see this happening. Decompression with a white core needle and anticoagulant injection. In today's date, do we have this option available?
The only issue is the recurrence rate are quite high, Chirag.
Yeah.
So if you go for aspiration, patient may come off after 2 or 3 months with the recurrence.
Yeah. Dr. Rajiv, any role of just arthroscopic ministering without decompressing the cyst?
Yes, definitely. See, I will go for option 4, so arthroscopic cyst decompression, C for the unstable layer, and balance your meniscus. If you have a good void there, repair that part.
Okay, let's just go into the surgical video.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Nagraj is having a question. Nagraj.
Yeah, please.
So I just wanted to add that, you want me to come later? Yeah, I just wanted to add that with this sort of a cyst, which is so visible outside, and it has got a cyst wall, most of the time they are multiloculated.
Yes.
Like Chirag mentioned, probably the best option would be arthroscopic meniscectomy, part meniscectomy, cyst decompression through the tear, cystectomy or cyst wall excision through whatever modality you could, and then whatever preservation you could by closing the meniscus repair.
Yes. So
you could do all of those step by step.
Yeah, Dr. Ashit?
I said the same thing.
Yeah. So number three. This is how the tear looked like. The first thing what we did was the avascular zone. We did the white zone. We did go and did a partial meniscectomy and then took the shaver and furthermore advanced our meniscectomy, and we restricted the meniscectomy to only the white zone. And as we do that, we see that now the tear is more of a horizontal cleavage kind of a tear. It's more well defined now, and we are able to see the cyst completely. And the next thing what I did was did a outside in cyst decompression with a wide bore needle. I think this is very important. As we do this, we can see that the cyst opening up and the fluid seeping in. Sometimes if we do only an inside cyst decompression, we may refrain from opening up the lateral or the outside cyst aspect. It's also very important that we rasp or clear out the inner cyst wall, that is the cystectomy. It's very important that the cyst wall is decompressed. As Dr. Anil said, probably he would use a fibrin clot there, or else if we do not want to use that, we need to get a good fresh bleeding surface, and putting in your favor, cleaning off that cyst wall is very important before we go ahead and repair. Now, once we have done that, how many of us would actually go in and repair the meniscus? Dr. Nagraj, would you, at this stage, when you have a good debridement, you have good stable flaps, would you just leave it at this or go ahead and repair the meniscus?
If you would have asked me this question, say about 2 years back, Chirag, then probably the answer would have been balancing and coming out. Now I think there's a lot of literature that is coming out from, I think, University of Connecticut, that these they have done a long-term study, which I think is going to be coming out in December, wherein they have repaired specifically horizontal cleavage tears. They have seen the healing. They have seen the better functional outcomes. And we need to understand this is a young lady, your patient, who has a tear on the lateral side. And like you have also been mentioning, you need to be more aggressive on repair on the lateral side, because the lateral meniscectomy is not as well tolerated a procedure as a medial meniscal tear. So definitely I would repair this.
Yeah, so I am of the same thought. I think we should give all possible options and all possible modalities of treatment for this kind of a tears, especially in younger individuals where the rest of the meniscus looks all right. We need to do a partial meniscectomy, excise the cyst wall, do an outside in cyst puncture as well, and probably go ahead and repair the meniscus. It's always better that we close the mouth of this kind of a fish mouth kind of a tear. If we leave it open, we are always leaving the job half without closing the fish mouth. This could be probably sequence of a cyst. So if you use an all inside device, I would put one stitch on the upper flap and another stitch on the inner part of the lower flap, and close the cyst wall, or I would close the horizontal of the tear. I would either use one suture or two to get a good meticulous repair, and the repair should look the same after your
I think it's very important to repair it.
Yeah, it's very important to repair that. What would be, does the panel have any take on when we would like to do an outside open taxation? Yeah, Dr. Mary.
So, everything correct. You do a partial meniscectomy, you expose the horizontal cleavage, which I call the window into the cyst. Instead of decompressing from out to in, I would always go through the horizontal tear into the cyst. I'll keep my finger on the cyst and see my shaver blade in the cyst and then shave it. Thus, taking care of the multiloculi, which Nagaraj mentioned, is very important. If the cyst is a little bigger in size, many times we see cysts almost 3 to 4 centimeters, I will not hesitate to open from the outside and decompress it. Still repair the meniscus using the inside to out technique. And the lateral side is already open, so it's very easy for me to co-opt the meniscus and close the capsule. So basically, the principles are the same. You need to expose the window into the cyst, thus you do a partial meniscectomy. Debride the cyst either from in to out, out to in, or open. And then we need to close the window. We need to repair it. Otherwise, it's going to recur. In a patient of such a young age of 35 years old and lateral side.
We are of the same thought, Dr. Mehir.
Yes, absolutely.
Sometimes what we see is partially the cyst is on one side of your LCL and partially on the other side of the LCL. So when you decompress from inside out, you have certain restrictions. You cannot go beyond your meniscus with your shaver. So that's one of the reasons why I always, if I feel that it's a multiloculated cyst, first I decompress from inside and to give it no chance of an error, I also decompress from outside in, so as in probably get in a thorough decompression. Any thoughts on this from the panel?
Yes, Chirag, completely agree. For large cyst and multiloculated cysts, don't hesitate to open from outside also. So, because most of the time it can be tackled well by opening from outside. And most of the large cysts, I think the standard practice should be open it and you can close it also jolly well. Because closure of this such a large wide arthroscopically is a very difficult task, very difficult task.
In fact, few of the large multiloculated cysts on the medial side, we also need to open up your MCL and then close it back again.
Yes, so yes.
Situations where I've opened up the MCL and re-repaired it.
So the only thing I'd like to add here, when you put your needle from outside and you saw the seepage of fluid, that basically meant that you have punctured the cyst. So if I have that sort of a situation, I will use it like a transcystic portal. That same track, I will use it like a portal, put my shaver through it and start shaving this whole multiloculated cyst.
Yes.
Sometimes you need to observe the MRI carefully, whether it is tracking at the level of the meniscus above or below. So if it is tracking below also, you can create another submeniscal portal. Mm-hmm. Use it like a transcystic portal and put your shaver through the submeniscal track and shave it off also. That's the only point.
Yeah. I think it's a straightforward case. The takeaway message would be leave no stone unturned in such cases so that we do not have any sort of recurrences in meniscal cysts. Recurrence is always a problem in meniscal cyst cases. Thank you.
Okay. Yes, Nagaraj, you can share your case.
Yeah.
Swapnil, you have a question. Yes.
Yes. Yeah, to the all faculty, what is the approach for the recurrence of cyst?
Open.
If you have any, exposed to any recurrence of the cyst,
yes.
How you have tackled?
Yeah, open and three-level closure.
Open and?
Three-level closure.
Okay.
Synovium capsule.
When usually there is no meniscal tear fresh.
Yeah, so probably there is a cyst wall which is left unremoved, or else that cyst wall could be the chance of recurrence. That's why always outside in.
So open,
deployed, close thoroughly, meticulously, three-layer closure.
Mihir, what's the point of the guess?
So I agree with Chirag. If there is a recurrence, it is always open because the intra-articular part has been taken part in the index procedure.
Absolutely.
The reason for recurrence is these parameniscal cysts are usually degeneration in the peripheral menisco-capsular junction, and hence all these repair techniques may not hold because the capsule is very lax. And in this case, you need to go, you open it, and as Chirag said, you need to do a multi-layer closure to shut that rent or the window, which I call, which lets the synovial fluid seep under the IT band. I have seen recurrences which are much more bigger than the primary cyst, and the patients are very irritable. And in this case, it's very important, number one, to do a tight closure or to maintain compression post-op, and also have be slow in mobilization so that you get good fibrosis, thus shutting the rent, which causes the synovial fluid to seep out, causing the recurrence.
In my earlier case also, where the meniscus repair is not done, the recurrence rate is high. But when we do the meniscal repair, as you said rightly, that the synovial fluid seepage is no more there, and the chance of recurrence are very less.
Always we should repair that word, always.
Yes. Here, Asit, there is a question for you. Will drilling on the medial wall of lateral condyle will give the same effect as so many fluid?
Yes, it does. It does. If it is pertaining to the meniscus repair, and if the question is related to the fibrin clot that I just mentioned, it definitely helps. Yes, and somebody mentioned that when you are having only a meniscus tear, and then you are not doing an ACL surgery, it is a good thing to do.
Okay, that was a question from Dr. Vivekanand Degaukar. Rajiv, you have got a congratulatory message. One of our friend, Dr. Ananda Perera, is watching from Sri Lanka.
Yes. Very good friend, yes.
He has written, great to see Rajiv. Excellent webinar. Thanks for sharing your experience, Rajiv. Yes. Yes. Yeah, I remember the time we spent with him in Siliguri Trauma Meet last time, and Gorumara.
Yeah.
Botan.
Yeah. Very nice person. Yes.
Yes, Nagraj, you can go ahead.
Yes, sir. Thank you for this opportunity. I have presented this in the past in our forum. So sorry for the guys who have already seen this presentation, but it's a very important technique, as in how our audience is going to progress in their meniscus repair journey, because this particular tear pattern is catastrophic once it happens to the knee. And what is unique, unlike other radial tears, which is very common in the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus, which is common around the medial meniscus root area, all of us are aware. This is a rare case where it's a young patient, non-degenerative knee, and there was a radial tear through and through at the level of the body of the medial meniscus. So that's the first thing why I'm presenting this. All of us are aware that radial tears are especially biomechanically devastating injuries because they actually cut through the meniscus like a scissor, which is going through the meniscus. Like I just said, this is something which all of us are aware. Lateral meniscus, radial tears near the root, all of us usually repair this with various techniques, either using scorpion-like devices or using all-inside devices. And we are pretty much aware of how to go about this. It has been shown by Christopher Hahner in his earliest publication, actually, which this is the one study which brought to notice that you need to repair these radial root tears, because otherwise, if you resect them, the knee, it's as good as doing a total meniscectomy on the knee, and the knee will land up with rapid osteoarthritis in a very short duration of time. Dr. Laprade has also spoken about the importance of the root tears and the radial tears near the root, and all the techniques are now available for the radial root tears. Now, it has been shown that the meniscus repair is at the level of the lateral meniscus root is an extremely good modality with excellent healing rates. And there are various techniques that have been published. I wouldn't go into this technique much, but you always have to rasp it, and then you can use your all-inside devices. This is not the crux of my talk today. You need to be careful of the neurovascular structures. You need to come from the diagonally opposite portal. You could also use, like I just mentioned, knee scorpion-like devices. Pass your stitches through each component of the radial tear, and then you can tie, like in the shoulder, a sliding knot, and you can have a nice repair. What I want to present is a 40-year-old gentleman who presented to me with severe pain and rapid deterioration in terms of the pain within a matter of few weeks. He had medial joint line tenderness. His alignment was normal. It's very important to get the alignment done, scanogram done in these cases. Never ever compromise by doing only a weight-bearing X-ray. His alignment was normal. This was the MRI axial image. And I would encourage all the young arthroscopists to ask your radiologist to give you this axial image, because as you can see here, you can see that radial tear, and you can make out that it is starting from the white zone, going through the red-white zone, almost up to the red-red zone. So you know the gravity of the situation when you look at this image, and you are prepared well in advance, because it is as good as cutting the meniscus through. These are the other images which are telling us about the radial tear of the meniscus through and through.
Now, obviously, the treatment options are whether you want to do a meniscus repair with all inside devices, inside out technique, or side to side stitches. These are the three techniques which we just saw for radial tears elsewhere. And these have been well described. But this is the arthroscopy of this gentleman, 40-year-old gentleman. So this is the right knee view from the anterolateral portal. The hook probe is coming from the medial portal. And now when you see, you will realize that this is a radial tear through and through, going all the way to the red zone. And if you are not careful about this, if you don't plan it, and if you start resecting, you will suddenly realize that you have created two separate pieces of meniscus and there is no connection between the two. And then you would not be able to do anything. So that is the red zone extension of this radial tear. This tissue is very, very, very friable. It is very, very important for you. You need to respect this tissue and therefore do not resect it at all. That is the first take home message. And the two tunnel technique by Laprade is probably the only technique which will give you a stable outcome. I have a follow-up of this patient also to show. And that's the two tunnel technique that I want to show. It has been well published. This is the article for those of you who want to go and read about it. I do my arthroscopies in the leg holder with the leg hanging down. You need to make these markings. So you have the oblique incision on the anteromedial tibia through which you're going to create these tunnels. You need to have a safety incision because you're going to do the inside out repair also, like I'm shown here. I do the pie crusting, like I said, from the tibial side. I use the 18 gauge needle from the TUR set and just target the superficial MCL fibers posteriorly and the posterior oblique ligament. And I get a good space of working around 20-30 degree flexion. I stop when I feel my instruments are not going to scuff the cartilage at all. So that's the kind of first step. You have a thorough pie crusting. You would do the rasping. What's very important is you need to not just rasp the edges of the meniscus, but you also need to rasp the synovium and the capsule around, because that's where the macrophages are going to come in and help in your repair. You need to spend a lot of time in rasping the meniscus. You can use your microfracture awl for creating trephinations. You can use your inside out needles again to create the trephinations. And you need to have a nice biological environment. Otherwise, these tears are not going to heal. So that's the first thing. So that's the synovium being rasped. Always rasp your synovium in your meniscus repairs. So that's the first, second tip. Then I'm planning my tunnels. I need to have a tunnel at the posterior portion of the tear and one at the anterior portion of the tear. And that is going to put the meniscus back into place. So these are dedicated jigs as per the side of the knee involved. So the right-sided jig, I take it in such a way that I create a tunnel posteriorly first. So that's the first tunnel being passed. That's the PCL depth stop being used. So I know that my wire doesn't come into the middle of the joint. So we have to understand that this is a 90-degree knee flexion position. You will suddenly come into the joint and scuff the cartilage. On the right-hand side, you can see the offset guide. So once you pass the posterior wire, you can create the offset guide at 5 millimeter, 6 millimeter, 7 millimeter anterior to the first wire. So that's the offset guide coming in, the second wire being planned. So that's the tentative plan. This is how it looks. This is the arthroscopy video of the same. So the jig coming in, you need to protect your cartilage to the best of your capacity, place it on the posterior portion, create the first tunnel. You can see that I passed a spinal needle from an accessory portal and using it like a retractor because it's difficult to work in this area otherwise. These are the two tunnels. And now you need to pass stitches through the tunnel. So you have these anti-grade devices. Use different color coding of the suture material. So I'm using a cobrate kind of a material here for the first stitch to the posterior half of the tear. And this is from the medial portal. I retrieve it to an accessory transpatellar tendon portal. The second stitch is now coming from the anterolateral portal. So I'm visualizing now from the medial side, and the second stitch is coming from the anterolateral portal. Make sure that your needle is fired away from the condyle. Otherwise, sometimes you'll break the tip of the needle. So you need to turn the device away from the condyle. That's another important tip. So two color codings. So it tells you which is the one through the anterior portion, which is the one through the posterior portion. I'm retrieving it through an accessory medial portal. So there is a anterolateral portal, anteromedial portal, transpatellar tendon portal, and an accessory medial portal. Now, this is an important trick. Before you withdraw your guide wire, which is just a 2.4 guide wire, you can keep a lasso-like device and pass it right through that 2.4 drill, and you just turn it around sequentially, which slightly dilates that particular area. So lasso device is now visualized inside the joint. Your shuttle relay is pushed inside the joint, and The posterior stitch is passed through the anterior tunnel, following which the anterior stitch is passed through the posterior tunnel. So that's the kind of trans-osseous pull-out stitch repair that you're going to get. You're not going to stop at that. You're going to tie it over an endo button. So your endo button comes in. So you can use a regular endo button and use the stitches from the endo button for the passage and then the button itself for fixation on the tibia. So that's the endo button and then you go ahead with the fixation in near extension. That's routine. So that is what your appearance will look like. You don't stop at this. You further add inside out stitches because you need to understand that you need to repair the upper surface and the undersurface of the meniscus. So that's my inside out stitch going above the meniscus. So I put two above and two below. So this is the tips and tricks for the safety incision. I use the hook probe to create that safety incision. All of us are aware about this. You create the plane between the posterior medial capsule and the medial head of the gastroc. These sort of low profile cannulae are helpful in turning the device 180 degree above, below. So that's the stitch which is passing below the meniscus. You need to drop the knee into flexion, otherwise it will not deflect through the spoon. So once you pass through the meniscus, drop it into 30-40 degree flexion, and then the assistant will catch the needle at the back. So two side-to-side stitches from top, two side-to-side stitches from below. I tie the stitches immediately. I don't wait until the end, otherwise there is a lot of suture madness. And that's the kind of, with a knot pusher I tie it because these wounds are quite deep. And that's the kind of final repair that you get. So two inside out stitches on top, two inside out stitches on below. This was the case of isolated meniscus repair. So I did the notchplasty and the microfracture like we've been discussing. And you can make sure that the bone marrow elements are coming in. Now it does appear as if whether this will actually heal or no. So I have followed this patient up. So the advantage of this technique is that you are preparing the meniscus, you're preparing the capsule, you're creating transosseous tunnels where the bone marrow elements are coming in. You're creating a biomechanically strong construct in addition to the pull-out stitches by doing the inside-out repair. And therefore, this is the follow-up MRI. You can see the previous surgery, before surgery MRI on top, left-hand side top. And you can see that the signals have really gone at about 9 months post-op, I think. You can see the tunnels in place. The meniscus has healed quite well. This is the important point, that the meniscus repair evidence is there. There is no extrusion suggesting that the body has accepted this meniscus. And the medial compartment articular cartilage is preserved. So that is a very gratifying outcome. So a young patient can have this sort of a tear, which is otherwise considered to be a degenerative kind of a tear. So my take home message is the radial tears, especially at the mid body, are important to be identified. Be prepared with these sort of advanced techniques. Do not do the meniscectomy first. Do the repair first, and then you can probably trim the edges. A biomechanically weak repair is not enough. Just side-to-side stitches are not enough. The Lapra two-tunnel technique in addition to the inside-out repair stitches is going to get you the outcomes. Thank you.
Thanks, Nagaraj. I think we have third case from... Yeah, Mihir, Dr. Mihir, then Swapnil will have a fourth case, I think.
Is my presentation visible?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so I'm presenting a case of a complex meniscal tear and how I managed it. This was a 40-year-old male, bus conductor by profession, gives a history of fall from bus, a right knee twisting injury, and presents within about 2 weeks of injury. The right knee on clinical examination has fullness. His knee range is relatively good, 0 to 90 degrees. Lachman's test is positive and a valgus stress test is positive at 0 and 30 degrees of knee flexion. So the imaging MRI shows a complete ACL tear from the femur, MCL tear from the femur on a complex tear of the lateral meniscus. So my treatment plan was to stage the entire treatment. I told you that I usually don't do a lot of intra-articular procedures in an acute stage. So my first stage was a diagnostic arthroscopy and a meniscal surgery. And at the same time, I went ahead with meniscal repair. And at stage two, I did an arthroscopic ACL reconstruction. So this was the examination under anesthesia. You can see valgus opening significant at complete extension and 30 degree flexion. This is the complete ACL tear from the femur. You can see the drive through sign is positive in the medial compartment. The medial meniscus, however, is intact. And my scope can go literally up to the posterior and horn of the medial meniscus. The opening is almost more than 8 to 10 millimeters, which you can see from the tip of my probe. Now, coming to the lateral side, we see a complex lateral meniscal tear in the region of the tendon of the popliteus, probably more posterior. There are 3-4 different flaps. And what is important to see is the vascularity is completely coming up to the WW zone, as you can see in the section of the meniscus. There are some complex flaps in different configuration and very difficult to label this kind of tear. So I decided to go ahead with repair. Now, as I told you, Rajiv, I work in a municipal setup where cost is a very big factor. And using different amount of sutures are very difficult. So I use the anti-grade device, but I use a number one Ethylon as a shuttling device. And I use number two Ethimond as my final suture to repair all my meniscal tears. So this is like repairing a shoulder rotator cuff. I go ahead with a side-to-side repair. There is a lot of complex shuttling that occurs because I want the number two Ethimond as the final suture to hold the meniscal tear together. Very important to see that we get good coaptation of the tear. And then we use shoulder instruments to intra-articularly knot the Ethimond to get the meniscus together. So single suture gives me very good coaption. However, you can see that there is some separation already. And hence, I decide to use one more suture passage to close the tear. So again, I use the anti-grade suture passing device. In this case, is the knee scorpion. Very important to ensure that Nagaraj said that the needle doesn't hit the femoral condyle because the needles are very thin and can break and very difficult to retrieve them. Again, a lot of suture shuttling. And then side-to-side repair to close the entire radial and complex lateral meniscal tear. At the end of the repair, that is the side-to-side repair, I realized that there is separation at the capsulomeniscal junction. And thus, I use the in-to-out technique to put the entire construct firmly against the capsule. So these are the intra-articular knots that you can see using number two Ethimond. And then I use in-to-out technique, the double barrel cannulas, to fix the entire construct firmly against the meniscus, against the capsule. So that's the completed product. The entire meniscus tear is repaired, fixed firmly against the capsule. And following this, I go ahead with an open MCL repair using suture anchors. This is a standard technique. The MCL was avulsed off the femur, very firmly fixed, layers closed. And that's the post-operative X-ray. You can see the two suture anchors in the femoral condyle at which site the MCL was repaired. With respect to rehab, the patient was immobilized for about 2 weeks. Range of motion was started after that. Non-weight bearing mobilization was started 4 weeks and quadriceps strengthening was started. Stage two, I took up after 3 months. Basically, I was waiting for the full range of motion to come back and having good quadricep power. And at the time of ACL reconstruction, you can see the second look arthroscopy that the lateral meniscus is very much in place. There is this synovial tissue, which I realized covers up all the sutures, covers up the tear. And on gentle probing, we can see that all the meniscus is nicely coapted. Now, whether there is fibrous tissue holding it or what is holding it, we don't know. But the entire meniscus is still in shape. The worry about whether the Ethimond number 2 would cause attrition to the cartilage is absolutely not there because I think nature or the synovium nicely takes care of all these things. A post-operative, we can see he's got very good knee function at about 2 months post-op. Good quadricep function, he's got a good complete extension. So the crux of the case is that meniscus has good healing potential, especially this acute lateral meniscal tear, which are located posterior to the popliteus. And as I said, the vascularity in these tears come literally up to the articular edge. And hence, on the lateral side, we should restrict our meniscectomy options and go ahead with repairs as much as possible. And especially in an acute injury, a young age, and when you are doing a cruciate ligament reconstruction, I think repair is always a very good option in these patients. Thanks.
Any questions to Dr. Nagaraj, Mihir, Chirag?
Nobody. Yes, Dr. Nagaraj, you.
So
Apnil has got a question.
Yes, Apnil.
Okay, so Nagaraj, it was really excellent presentation. I mean, from first stage to last completely with a good follow-up. So really we need to, in radial tears, we really need to all these things, or we can take one or two horizontal sutures and Mihir sir has shown that we can fix it from the posterior capsule. Or really we need, because if we took a tunnel in the tibia, do you think that the meniscus get fixed with the tibia and the mobility is reduced?
So that's a very valid question and a very good question. And this has been addressed by a German study. That was the concern when this technique was described. And they did the cadaveric studies. They found that the biomechanical strength was good, but was it too strong? The German study has said that the normal meniscus mobility vis-a-vis the tunnel repair technique mobility, it's not much different. The normal medial meniscus is as such not such a mobile structure. So that has not been the concern. This is reserved not for all radial tears. This is reserved only for the tears which are...
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah, we can hear you, Nagaraj. Some network issue is there.
Network issue.
Yeah.
Yes, any question to Mihir? Last presentation.
I think let me complete Dr. Nagaraj's statement.
Yeah.
These are for transections. Complete radial tear. Transections extending into the capsule, which are unstable and probably which would require an augment as well. So he is doubly securing this repair.
If the tear is not going up to the capsule, I mean the meniscus annual junction is not injured and there is only a vertical tear throughout the meniscus, then we can repair it in a horizontal way.
Yes.
You mean a radial tear?
Yeah. Radial tear. It's only a crisscross technique which is that has been described that you can use. But I think what Nagaraj showed that you have to fix the bony tunnel, and he has told what he was telling about the German study, they have shown the biomechanically the fixation is very strong. The only issue with this radial tear is a poor, I think, the high failure rate. You can say high failure rate of this repair of this radial tear. If you see all the meniscus tear you repair, the radial tears have a very high failure. So these techniques, bony techniques, have come out.
So 5 years back, probably radial tears were considered as one of the irreparable tears. And now we are repairing more and more of radial tears.
Radial tears, yes.
I usually do a hashtag repair. It's almost similar to what Dr. Mihir showed. It's just to, just like a horizontal repair with an additional sutures on the side so that it doesn't cheese the effect of the sutures are not there cutting through. That's all.
Yes, so Rajiv, this is what I do to save cost. What happens is in a government setup, I don't have the luxury of 2-0 fiber wire. So I would use a knee scorpion, which I have bought and is always in my set. So even if I'm encountered with a tear, I'm not surprised because I have my instruments ready and autoclave. So I would use a number one Ethylon to shuttle, exactly like what we do on a shoulder. And I'll shuttle a number two Ethylon, which is always there in my operation setup. So that entire repair that you saw was only in a cost of 1200 rupees.
Yes. Cost so effective.
Considering that a 2-0 fiber costs almost 2,500 rupees a single fiber.
Yes.
So that is what, you know, I think necessity, you know, is the mother of all inventions. And that is why I managed to cut the cost for our patients.
Yes, agreed.
And do we all do the sutures on the upper part of the meniscus or inferior to the meniscus? Or is there any advantage or disadvantage for that?
Yeah, in the case that which I presented, it was more of a radial tear, complete radial tear, you know, like a scissoring which Nagaraj was talking about. So it's something like the rotator cuff. You know, we don't do an under surface tear or upper surface in a complete thickness rotator cuff. Okay. Having said that, there is a lot of discussion about under surface repair in case of a bucket handle medial meniscus. where usually we repair on the upper surface and we see the meniscus lifting up. And for every third stitch on the top, we would put one stitch below. So yes, to balance the repair upper and below, I think you should put an undersurface repair to put the meniscus back down. I would do it in a bucket handle, yeah.
No, no, I am asking about this radial tear, whether it's better to take the knots on the superior surface or inferior surface. And
so
how many
So it's very technical, it's a technical procedure. What I feel is putting the intra-articular knots in the submeniscal region is extremely difficult.
Absolutely.
What happens is then your instruments are actually going tangential and, you know, probably to the tibial articular surface. The femoral condyle being circular gives you advantage of some space in the supra-meniscal space. And I was worried that the knots would cause attrition. But at the second look, arthroscopy at 3 months, I mean, the synovium and nature had beautifully covered all the knots over, you know.
Yes.
So this, that feature that we have about attrition because of the sutures, after seeing a 2 or 3 second look arthroscopies, has really boosted my confidence. Then I'm not worried about the knots.
I just lost the connection when you were asking the question about whether you need to do this transosseous pullout always. So no, the answer is you don't need to do it always, but you need to understand that if you rely only on the inside out repair or side to side repair, many of the times the tissue quality is very poor. What he showed was a traumatic tear in an ACL patient. These are completely different varieties than radial tears in these varieties. The tissue quality is very poor. You will be surprised they can just cut through like a cheese cutting through. So these are reserved for such cases like you saw where the tissue quality is poor. You know for sure that a side-to-side repair is not enough and it's a through and through tear. So it's a backup option for such tears.
Okay. But Nagaraj, just the same thing. The problem is it is a good technique, but the tissue quality is same whether you do side-to-side or you do bony tunnels. You know, it's like doing a rotator cuff repair where the bone quality is poor. And then I'm told that if their bone quality is poor, you do transosseous. But the problem is bone quality is poor. So I think what is important is, yes, it works well. Probably a second look arthroscopy or a long-term study will help us. But this is a technique that we should keep in our armamentarium. Because in the kind of tears that you showed, I don't think anything else would work.
Anything else would
non-cruciate injury kind of case. I agree.
Correct.
Okay. I don't think, are there any more case presentation?
No, Dr. Swapnil video, there's issue with Dr. Swapnil video. Ashit, you are having any case? No.
No, no.
No, no. All right.
Okay. Okay. I think we had a wonderful discussion about the basic injuries. Oh, Ashit, you have to mute. You are disturbing a lot. That's why I always request people not to lock from two instruments because that will cause a lot of echo. They will not understand from their end, but it will be only heard at our end. Anyway, thank you, Rajiv, for that wonderful talk on meniscal injuries, covering almost all the varieties and how you are tackling. Nagaraj, for that beautiful way of a difficult repair you have shown. Meer also for that wonderful case. Chirag for that cyst, meniscal cyst, how to manage and how to do intra-meniscal scooping and other things to get a best results. Thank Asit and Swapnil. So without much ado, I would like to say bye-bye. See you next time for one more talk, because I know Rajiv is busy now for the next webinar at 7 o'clock. So I don't want to hold him for too long. Thank you very much. Thank you. Bye-bye. I would like to thank